It is now 20 minutes after 7 on this 18th day of August 2015. It's time for us to have our person of interest. Now, on person of interest, what we do, we take a 360 look at certain individuals. And today, who we have in the studio is Dr. James Mwangi. Dr. James Mwangi is the Chief Executive Officer for Equity Bank. And many of us do know Equity Bank is one of the banks that is known in Africa and world over for changing the way banking is done. And they continue to revolutionize our thinking and our way of banking. And thank you for joining us, Dr. James Mwangi. We appreciate you and are glad to have you in the studio.
Thank you, Micah.
I know it's a busy schedule for you, so to have an hour of your time is definitely, we are glad that you could do that.
I'm glad to be here, Micah.
All right. That's now, before we go into, you know, Equity Bank and the business, and I know that's where your passion is, that's where you flow, and you just talk naturally, but let's start from the beginning. Who is Dr. James Mwangi? Where did you grow up, for instance?
Thank you very much, Micah. I was born in Rulo, Kenya, on the slopes of the Abadea. Went to Rulo Primary School, Nyagatogo, where we used to climb a hilly terrain every morning, 4 kilometers and 4 kilometers in the evening. And then was admitted to Ishagaki Secondary School, also in the same Maranga district, but in Malagwa, and eventually to Kagumo High School. From where then was admitted to Nairobi University. So James is that ordinary Kenyan child growing in the rural areas. Then Nairobi University did my degree in commerce, focusing and specializing in accounting, and then ended up auditing, where I was Mwangi, today Ernst & Young, and eventually in banking. And that's how I've spent
all right, you've talked about going to a primary school where you're going up the hill and down the hill in the morning and in the evening. What are some of the memories you have of your school days, particularly primary school?
I think today, on reflection, I think the most visible thing is the community life. Boys of the village, we could spend days together, particularly weekends, herding together. The community way of life is what I remember most. The social networks that were built between families, the aunties, the uncles, the visits that we did, and the community approach towards issues like building houses, preparing land for planting. But more importantly also is today looking at the change that is most visible is climate change. Mm-hmm. We grew in an area that was very foggy during the month of May all the way to August. And there were many streams. And amazingly, when I go home, those springs are no longer there. Mm-hmm. We used to chase after butterflies as young boys. You no longer see those butterflies. There has been a significant change, maybe in climate an ecosystem, than there has been in our lives.
Okay. Did you ever get into trouble as a young boy, and what did you get into trouble for?
Of course, we used to get trouble with our teachers. Mm-hmm. Of course, if we didn't report early enough.
Mm-hmm. Were you ever late to school?
Of course, once in a while. My career was very challenging. Sometimes it's rainy, you have no umbrella, there is no raincoat to cover yourself. On such occasions, you could take refuge on the way to school and be late. Occasionally, as boys, would make noise and be punished by school. But remember, that was the time that we had a lot of respect for teachers. Occasionally, a teacher would pass by closer to your compound and you don't see them and you don't start. And that would be a punishment of being disrespectful. So there were quite a bit. And of course, the growing of boys once in a while, you are looking after cows and then you get detracted by hunting rabbits. Mm-hmm. And you lose
track of time
and where the cows are. And essentially they end up and graze somebody's shaba. Mm-hmm. And that will be big trouble.
Okay.
So Michael was...
You've talked about respect to teachers and possibly even the education system, and it'd be interesting to hear what you have to say in terms of where we are today, given that there are so many things that have been removed. There was a reason why you were being asked to stand up if a teacher is passing by. There was a certain respect that was accorded to teachers and elders, which is no longer there. Where do you think we are, and how did we get here?
As I said, Michael, the most visible thing is that we have moved away from community life. We used to be punished by every elder who found us doing wrong. You didn't need to be reported to your parent. Everybody who was the age of your parent was your parent. Anybody who was older than you was your elder brother or elder sister and could correct you. So the order of society was very well articulated. The bond between teachers and parents towards education, the alignment was very, very visible. So I would say societies worked in a synchronized way and pursued common interest. I think that is very different today.
That has changed. Has it changed for the better, do you think?
I think the assertion for individual independence and individualism in this country might not be for the good of the society, neither for good for the individual. Because what we are really lacking is the social network that holds us together. It's where society cares for its own. And that is why you find during those old days, children, orphans would be very well taken care of by the community. The society catered for everybody and provided for the advancement of everybody. A bright child was the pride of the whole village, and the whole village would contribute to their education irrespective of their status. That is not really true today. You find individualism has set in motion in a big way. The family unit is now what one would call the nucleus unit. We have moved away from the extended family. The transformation moved the family to a bigger ecosystem, that again has broken. And public institutions were institutions for community, and everybody was devoted to their well-being and maintenance. That again is not true today. We seem to be disintegrating as a society. The fibers of society are becoming looser and looser and looser.
Okay. What were your favorite subjects when you were in school?
I think my most favorite subject at that age was mathematics. As I grew in secondary school, it became commerce and accounting. It became very, and of course at A-levels, I liked economics and geography quite a lot, and I did pretty well on those.
Okay, so you've always loved numbers.
I've loved numbers all along.
Okay. Yeah. Did you have a best friend in school, and where is he today?
Very well. One of my best friends at primary school was Jessie Kemani, who is now a teacher in secondary school. There is Alex Mogwe, today an engineer from Nairobi University, and Kemani Junior, who were my classmates, who is now a lecturer at Nairobi University. So we have maintained the relationships that we started.
And you still keep in touch?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Let's come now to your family life. Married?
Yeah, thank you very much. Married to Jane, that's nearly 30 years old. Both of us have been...
30 years old marriage?
Yes.
She's not 30 years old, just to make it clear.
She's 30 years old.
Just to make it clear.
And we have three boys, John, Evans and Alex, who have been a big blessing in our life. And we've lost our parents over time, both of us. So now we are head of family.
Okay. Yeah. And how did you meet your wife?
Thank you. A very nice question. Schools are very good platforms for meetings. It's beyond the lessons. You tend to get, if you look left and right, you tend to notice
a few people
that eventually you might find you share quite a lot in common. That's such a genesis of our relationship.
Do you remember your first date?
I can't remember, Michael. That would be best for Jane.
I'm sure she would remember, and I wish she was here to update us, and maybe you'd find the version of the story might be slightly different.
Slightly different, you know. I think ladies are privileged and endorsed with details. They're very good particularly with the dates and details of events and occasions and men are. Yeah.
What would you say her contribution has been to where you are today?
I think the greatest contribution for Jean One is friendship. In life over that span, I've had a true friend, a true companion. We have worked together for nearly those 28 years, working together, working together, building a trusting relationship. She has become a sounding board for me, acquiring a little bit, and then complementing each other in life. So we have different strengths. She's very caring, and we see that the upbringing of our kids to a great extent has been has seen Jane play a huge role. Mm-hmm. Taking care of our parents, Jane has really played a significant role. And essentially, keeping our home together, keeping the family together, whatever little we have, being the custodian of our savings, mm-hmm. I would say. But Jane is a very powerful woman, so I would say she's a player warrior. And I think upholding the family, and specifically me, in prayer, and this has been a very gift to me. Maintaining our family network and friends, she has played a bigger role than maybe I could. I don't know whether I could thank her enough and really articulate what Lord she has prayed in. I am because she is.
Hopefully she is watching right now. Maybe you can just speak into that camera and talk to her. What message would you have to her now that you have the opportunity?
I would say, Jane, I'm grateful for the path we have walked together. I'm grateful for your trust and love and care.
Okay. Now, one of the things that is under attack today is marriages. What has been your secret for staying with Jane for 30 years? I'm sure it's not been easy.
I think it's a long journey. And of course, I think it's communication. Open communication has been really the biggest web that has connected us together and making. And the second one I would say is building trust, that you could be able to look at each other and ask a question and expect an honest answer. So I would say communication and trust have been the biggest pillars for our continued success in marriage.
Okay. Mine is mainly consists of the physical, the intellectual, and the spiritual. Maybe let's start with the spiritual. How does James Mwangi, Dr. James Mwangi, take care of his spiritual being?
Thank you very much. As I said, I was born in a very Christian family, a very spiritual mother, who I was very privileged to live with in my house for the last of her last 15 years. And you have this prayer warrior who prays for you by name every day and fading, and reminds you of your relationship with God. And that, I would say, was the biggest inheritance as a family that we got, particularly because my wife became very strong also. And that really builds this, the unit of the family, having a spiritual life together, praying together, reading the Bible together. And I would say I find answers quite a lot in the spiritual world. Okay. I find a lot of answers in reading the Bible, because there's quite a lot that you could pick there. And I'm also very privileged to have a lot of friends, canons and bishops who we have communion with, including in my office, having Bishop Kariuki, my chaplain, who we keep together, praying together, because the journey is not easy. So that is what I would say about the spiritual.
So are you saved?
It's a very interesting question, Michael. And I think I look at Jane and ask, what would she think
about it? Maybe Jane should answer that. Okay, not a problem. What about the physical? Do you work out?
Oh, very well. I think to keep fit both in mind and body. You need that workout, particularly us who sit for long hours in offices. So I wake up early, like this morning, do 30 minutes of a treadmill, make sure you have a good start on the heart, the muscles are well relaxed, and then you find you have kicked up the heart for a long day. That's how I do it. I'm best in the morning because I'm a morning person, so that's what I do.
Excellent.
In the morning.
We're going to come shortly into, you know, the business side of you and Equity Bank, but what does Dr. James Mwangi do to unwind?
Quite a lot. I'm good in storytelling. I find the reflections and with close friends, with colleagues. I spend quite a bit of time there, particularly in reflecting and looking back for insights, and that helps me to prepare psychologically about both the past, the present, and the future. I spend quite a lot of time enjoying nature. I'm one person who have really benefited from our wildlife fauna and flora. Mm-hmm. I take quite a bit of time to go and really take time downtime, let me call it downtime, with nature, and such that you completely unwind and clear the mind from the day to day and appreciate what nature. I also like traveling a little bit, and a little bit of chats with friends. That's how I would say I spend quite a bit of time.
Okay. Do you have a favorite story? When you talk about storytelling, is it just recounting your life, or is it, you know, stories that, like, we knew in the olden days about a rabbit and a lion?
I think stories, there is one perspective of reading stories, experiences of other people. That I'm good at. And stories of experiences. It may not be necessarily relate to work, experiences that you have gone through, and essentially also stories that give lessons. And that has been very good, particularly with the children, looking back, and we tell stories and listen to their stories. It's not always about telling, it's listening to the others. Of course, it's not about the stories as we were told. That would not be really of interest. It's life stories. It's experiences that combines to make stories.
Okay. Your favorite food?
My favorite food is... I have three foods that I really rotate. Of course, there is the traditional Getheri from my community. Mm-hmm. That's really a favorite food. I also seem to like chapati quite a bit, and eventually I like irio. Those I would call them my staple.
So if anybody is inviting you for lunch, if they have those,
that would be favorite.
You'll enjoy.
Yes, and I like quite a bit of vegetables also.
Okay.
And particularly peas, the green peas. That's a favorite meal for vegetables.
Okay. Let's now move on to how you got into banking. You mentioned that you finished university. How did you get into banking?
Thank you very much. After finishing university and working for Wells Mwangi, an auditing firm, I was pushed by one of the banks that I was auditing. Mm-hmm. They seemed to have liked the way we were doing, climbed up the ranks to become a group financial controller of the bank. And then by default, Equity had been started by people in my village, and they were having problems. And they came to me and say, can you salvage this bank? So that's how then I moved to Equity Bank, to salvage a village circle in form of a building society. It had only branches in Kangema, Kereaine, and Moradia, which are within a radius of 7 kilometers, all the three of them. Mm-hmm. So I would call it a community building society. And that is how I was sucked into banking. And looking back, maybe that's how best I've spent my last 25 years helping build that institution.
Okay. Did you foresee Equity Bank getting to the level it is right now, especially at that point where they were just within a radius of 7 kilometers?
As I said, Michael, the calling was to salvage. It was a technically insolvent institution. Can you turn it loud? So obsession was turn loud initially. And then we said, after turn loud, what do we do? Then they said, now move away from a turn loud manager, develop strategy and provide leadership in finance. So I became a strategy finance director. That was in 1993. And then we saw, yes, can we transform the village using this institution? And that's where we started. And then we realized that the village was not big enough to provide the economies of scale that would support. So we extended a little bit to about 10 branches from the 4 branches we had. Did we see it becoming what it is today? I believe nobody could have ever imagined Equity being the size it is today, having the influence and the impact it has to, today. But we kept the ambition alive. And we never got satisfied. And eventually we now said, we'll build a global bank that will make Kenyans proud that they have one of their biggest iconic company will be Equity. Today, we're headed to 7 countries. So you can see we are now making Nairobi a financial hub. We could never have imagined that we would be the pillar of Nairobi becoming a financial hub. We could never have visualized that would be ranked Africa's best bank in terms of efficiency, both capital and asset deployment in the world. We never saw it coming. But what we did was continue to do the right things consistently, and growth kept on coming, and awards kept on coming. So in 2007, Equity won as the Global Vision Award with the caption, "Initiators of a concept of the future that will change the global economy." We didn't understand. But 5 years later, 2012, it won as the Forbes Person of the Year in Africa, right, and won as, the Ernst & Young World Entrepreneurs of the Year. So that kept on keeping the dream alive. So when today we are ranked the 8th best bank in terms of efficiency in the world, we now see this is a foundation for a great institution that hopefully will define and brand Kenya.
Okay, looking at Equity today, of course, we see how many huge strides that you have taken. But when you took over Equity, it was a building society, and the staff were demotivated, they had not been paid, it was in debt. How did you motivate them to continue working despite the fact that it looked very gloomy at that point?
Maybe for the listener to appreciate the journey we have done, as Michael said, Equity was technically insolvent. We had a deposit base of only 22 million shillings. We had a loan book of 9 million shillings. And we had shareholders' funds of 1 million shillings. But we had losses of 33 million shillings. And that's how it was defined technically insolvent. The number of branches were only 4. Number of staff were only 27. The only way was to really paint the big picture, move away from the picture as it was then and say, but out of these ashes, we can create a great institution. We could impact, and we created a big picture which became an inspiration to everybody that we could become. And as soon as success started trickling, it energized people. As we started taking shape and moving from number 66 out of 66, to 65, to 64, and eventually to today we rank ourselves number one, because last year we were the country's most profitable bank, we were the biggest bank in number of customers, the biggest bank in terms of members of staff, the most impactful bank in agriculture, in SME sector, and ranked in every category the best bank in Kenya by Think Business. We now see the journey that we have got. When we look back, what have been the biggest contribution is the inspiration that we got from the big picture. We said, this is not banking for the sake of banking. We are banking to empower our people to transform their lives. Mm-hmm. So as we saw one Kenyan transform their life after the other, we really got really motivated. Mm-hmm. So it is the concept of the greater calling. It's a big picture that has kept us. And then, okay, I must say we were lucky to have great leaders at the board level mm-hmm. that kept on encouraging us and allowing us at every stage to support the growth, either with the technology, either with the regional expansion, either with the conversion, either with raising money. So we kept on doing a few things that went extremely well, and that explains the great equity. And then we won the trust and hearts of Kenyans, and we continued. So today we have 10 million customers from 2,000 that support us. That support of Kenyans explains the size of Equity Bank. It's the aggregate value of the rise of 10 million people that is a measure of Equity Bank.
Okay. You as an individual, through your leadership and through Equity Bank making changes in the banking industry, have won quite a number of awards. Which one stands out for you most?
A couple of awards, Michael, stands out. The first one, as I said, was the Global Vision Award. Being named the winner of a Global Vision Award, I think in Germany during the G8 2007 was big. We came back to hand it over to President Kibaki. It was that big. Mm-hmm. Then 2012, being named the Forbes African Person of the Year, and 3 months later, the Ernst & Young World Entrepreneur of the Year. And looking at the 56 countries that had frontiered their best entrepreneur, and then Kenya winning that coveted position was great. But I think the most humbling thing was being given the challenge to lead Vision 2030 out of this. Is being given and awarded 5 doctorate degrees in recognition and in celebration of the work of Equity Bank. It's being asked to serve in the G8, G20, UN Advisory Council, the World Bank advice. That has been very, very humbling for me, but it has also been a great platform to learn. Being on the Clinton Global Initiative as an advisor, being on Obama's Global Development Initiative, being on the panel advising the British government on humanitarian aid, or advising Bill and Melinda Gates, has been very humbling, but also an excellent platform for me to learn. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Now, Equity was one of the Global Entrepreneurship Summit sponsors, and you came in a big way to ensure that you sponsor that. But now that the GES is gone, how does Equity intend to continue promoting and supporting SMEs?
Thank you very much, Michael, because Global Entrepreneurship Summit was just an event, and that marked the beginning of big work. What Equity did was to strategically position itself such that today we would say we are left with 53% of the total commitment that was left behind to support entrepreneurs. We have 53 billion shillings that for the next 7 years will continue to support entrepreneurs, and that is what we have really availed. But we have gone a little bit more ahead and say entrepreneurs in the innovation space will give them the Equity platform mm-hmm. To innovate on, and will give them the support. We'll do the mentoring and coaching, and where credit is not what is needed, we'll put together an investment bank and the advisory arm to help our entrepreneurs either to get to the capital markets or to get partners to boot capital. But I think the greatest is what we have aligned ourselves with Talo and African Oil mm-hmm. to try and build a value chain of our own local entrepreneurs to form the supply chain of the oil industry. Mm-hmm. That to me will be the greatest, because it would require about 60,000 entrepreneurs to support the oil industry. And starting that early enough so that our people participate, and then with the funding to make it happen, I think that will be the greatest contribution we'll make.
Okay. The Africa Development Bank did give some money towards having SMEs sorted out. How does one access this fund?
It is true. African Development Bank gave us $150 million, so all targeted to SMEs. This is in foreign currency, and what it does is that it allows our entrepreneurs to borrow at very low rates of between 8% and 10%, but in dollar. So what is it instead to do is to promote regional trade, people who will earn in foreign currency so that they can pay loans that they have obtained and get very competitive rates. The normal way to get this loan is just walk in your branch and make an application, and we evaluate, know what you want to do, prove that you'll be able to create revenues in foreign currency, just to ensure we cushion our customer against foreign exchange losses, which are really cripple most businesses. So it's walking into the branch and saying, this is what I'm doing, this is the support I would like to do, to get. And the good thing is a fund that is available for a long time. So it can also be used for development. It can be used for expansion, because we can give loans of up to 10 years.
Okay. We'll come to regional development just in a short while, but recently you also got the green light for Equitel. Maybe tell me a little bit about Equitel. First of all, it had a lot of controversy. And even having the approval done took a bit of time.
Thank you very much, Michael, for bringing out the issue of the big controversy. And that might have taught Kenyans how markets operate. Mm-hmm. That local entrepreneurs can be annihilated by multinationals that don't want development of a country and want status quo to remain. But the most exciting thing is that after being taken to Central Bank, CAK, Parliament, and three courts of law, we have been validated that there was no problem with the technology. It was about competition denying us as a chance to give Kenyans an alternative, to give Kenyans choice, and to give them freedom of making that choice. That is to us. Now, what is it all this about? We feel that the telecommunication industry is where banking was in the 80s, where really the needs of our people are ignored. It's a pride-driven. The market doesn't have a voice. Mm-hmm. Take it or leave it, mm-hmm. and take it as given. And that's what we are trying to change and say, should things always be this way, that we are voiceless and we have no say in consumption of products? And we said, no, will create a disruption in this market. The first disruption is the thin SIM, Michael. Right. The thin SIM is intended to convert the 27 million simple or fisher phones in this country into dual SIM phones, such that the 27 million people who have one SIM
cell phone with one SIM card
can now have two lines mm-hmm. connected to that phone. Mm-hmm. That gives them choice. They can then determine how the market will play by how they exercise that choice, by rewarding those who are giving them better prices, giving them better quality, and giving them the right product. That's the choice.
It just creates competition.
Absolutely.
Healthy competition.
Healthy competition. Mm-hmm. And competition of equals. Not a competition where it's not real competition. Mm-hmm. It's presence, but no competition. That is the first objective. The second objective was to say, if you are in banking, your core business is banking. If you are in telecommunication, your core business is value-add services. We feel should be given to population for free, but they can't become business. So we thought the 56 billion money transfer business in this country, that should never have been a business to anybody. It should have been a value add. So we said money transfer across networks will be free, such that you said money, because that is not our core business. That should be a value add service. It's like any other industry that says, okay, we'll add that.
Which, of course, the industry players may have said then is an unfair way of doing it, because you already have your core business. So why not concentrate on your core business and let the telecommunication concentrate on their core business?
Mobile money is core business to banking. It's not in telecommunication. Telecommunication is an infrastructure business. It's a voice business. It's a data business. It's not a money business. So essentially, we are saying, let's get it right. If you look at the money transfer, because it's not at the center, it's not at the core, all the people in the mobile money space their money is not protected. It's unlike money in banking, which is insured with the Deposit Protection Fund Board. Mm-hmm. All these stored value accounts are not protected. If anything happened, all that money would be lost and there would be no compensation. The second thing, that money has been done, and as I'm glad CAK is coming out to say, can we create transparent? Mm-hmm. It has been a black box. There is nothing you can show that you have money in stored accounts. Mm-hmm. If anything happens, if for instance, Michael, you lost, we were not able to get you, we moved out, that money doesn't move to your wife or to your family. Because there is nothing, there is no structure, there is no evidence, you have nothing to put on the table that you had. But lastly, and more important, is that to me, the way we did money transfer by creating virtual accounts, we killed one big aspect, the saving component. We moved our people from the SACCOS movement, from the chairmans, and said, here is virtual accounts. But virtual accounts, by law, cannot be allowed to hold the savings. Mm-hmm. So essentially, what did we kill? The saving culture in the country. We became a transaction nation. And if you look, our savings to GDP is the lowest in East Africa. All the other countries are headed between 18% and 24% of the GDP. Mm-hmm. That is what ours is, only 12%. Why? Because we and we're saying, can we recalibrate this and get it right? So that we help our nation. Some things look easy, but they are very expensive to an economy. And that's why you find no other country has accepted to do this model, a telecom-led model to money transfer. It is always a bank-led model. But remember, it was an experiment. Mm-hmm. But an experiment we carried too far without asking. But lastly, we also wanted to secure that aspect. You notice that we do that using SMS. What we have introduced is an SDK-based money transfer. We have introduced encrypting of data, such that it's really a safe channel to do banking. And lastly, it is the Equitel money transfer or Equity money transfer is very different. It lifts money from the bank account. We are removing the cash component. When money gets into your bank account, whether it's your salary, then you can lift it from your bank account straight and pay. And you are paying, and you have an evidence of the payments from your bank statement. So essentially, it's a very different innovation.
Change of paradigm shift in
and
our way of
Kenyans
banking.
Need to appreciate how power of this product with by checking the barriers that had been put in place to ensure they don't enjoy this product. Mm-hmm. And Kenyans need to ask, by the way, why was Equity taken to Central Bank, taken to CAK, taken to Parliament, taken to three courts of law, taken to the executive?
You want to answer that question for us? Why was that? Why did that, all that happen?
Because it was a liberating product. And not everybody wishes well to be free. As you saw, we took code 0763. Mm-hmm. It reminded us, while in 1963 we got political independence, we are now getting social and economic freedom for the first time. And it's not going to be easy. Equity has paid the ultimate price of having to fight over those barriers, delayed for a year, but now it's time for Kenyans to enjoy what we were fighting for, socio-economic liberation of our country, setting people free and giving them choice in the economic and social field. And those who have tested are telling stories. It's amazing. And I invite you.
So even the number 063 is based on the now another independence that you're talking about.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Wonderful. Now there's also the notion of equity riding on current infrastructure that has already been there, which was deemed as the industry players as unfair, not investing in the infrastructure on mobile telephony and just riding on what was already there with the thin SIM.
I think there is a misconception there. The thin SIM lights on two things. The phone owned by the Kenyan who is making the choice. That's the one. Mm-hmm. The second one is on the infrastructure of Airtel, which is a commercial agreement mm-hmm. of saying, why waste national resources by putting two masks in every locality? Why don't we share the mask and share the cost? Airtel is extremely happy. Equity is extremely happy. Any other partner, we share their infrastructure on roaming basis. There is no other sharing. No telecom can say we are riding on their infrastructure other than Airtel, and that's a commercial agreement.
That's a commercial agreement.
Yes. The others is all commercial agreement through roaming capabilities. Mm-hmm. We don't touch anybody else. That was a misrepresentation again mm-hmm. to Kenyans, to hoodwink them that Equity is trying to create advantage for itself. Mm-hmm. We don't use any other telecoms infrastructure, mm-hmm. and it is leased infrastructure from Airtel, which we pay for. And Airtel, I would say, is grateful. That's why they are always on our events. When we, like when we were launching, they came to support us. Mm-hmm. It's a win-win relationship.
Relationship. All right, we're going to go into something else shortly, but what are some of the revolutionary things that you see once now this has taken full throttle, you know, that since it?
Thank you very much. The first one, the most revolutionary one, is that we have created interoperability. With Equitel, you can send money to any telecom line. You don't even need to, that person need not to have an account. I can send money to your telephone line and you withdraw
regardless,
that money.
Regardless
of the telecom you are. Mm-hmm. We can send money to your bank account, irrespective of which bank the account is. So we created an open system that is contrary to the closed system that they existed
already.
Before. Mm-hmm. And now we can also send money to every credit and debit card, Visa or MasterCard. So we have now globalized it. So that was the second thing, is that it's free. So that
wow.
you give the Kenyans that interoperability mm-hmm. and also free, particularly within the Equity Airtel network.
Let me just give a practical example to see if I understand you, if I get you right. It's say, for instance, a relative travels to a different country and they're using a debit card. I, through that Equitel, can transfer money to their card and they can use it wherever they are.
You can send even, that's exactly true, but you can, if you have a son or a daughter studying in the U.S., you can send money to their card.
Wow.
Okay. That's what it means. The mm-hmm. second evolution mm-hmm. is that in that SIM card, we have created a planning, budgeting, and financing toolkit. When you get your money, you can plan for it, create the goals, allocate the money, yet the money is still in your bank account, and then you see how much. So there is no money now that remains. So what we always talk about, can we plan, can we budget? That is now inbuilt. The second most powerful one we're about to launch is what we are calling ChamaSoft. ChamaSoft is a software we have put available to all the chamas in Kenya, bookkeeping for them, keeping the diary for them, and every member is reminded when they are supposed to go for meetings. And then every member can see the balance mm-hmm. from, and when they are paying, they can pay the three signatories. Each one originates the transaction, and the transaction is sent to the other two signatories mm-hmm. just to put a pin, and money is settled. So chamas need now not have physical meetings. They can have virtual meetings, and they can all see.
Of even approving the payment and having the payment done.
Absolutely. Everything, head to head. Then we have Mchanga. Kenyans are known of supporting each other. Whenever there is a death and there is a funeral, we come together. We have now virtualized that. You can
community
have
community you are talking
community,
about.
Community, the community we were talking about. Mm-hmm. Now you can be holding Harambee virtually. You open an account every Monday, can see the contributions that are coming and how you are creating the budget. All that is. But more importantly, is supporting our children with education. There is an education curriculum that allows children to administer exams to their or homework to their children in the evening. Then there are health programs like pregnancy that would allow you to work with your wife through the 9 months pregnant, telling you every day what she's going through, when the vaccine are supposed to be, so you can accompany her to the all those
be
are put in, exactly they are put into the program. So there's so much that Kenyans need to know. That is why there was hullabaloo of trying to block Kenyans from the, and that's why we are calling it the Freedom SIM card. It's a freedom SIM card.
Wow. All right. Let's move on to something else now. And I know you're passionate about education, and especially for those who may be less fortunate. And as a result, you're the brainchild behind Wings to Fly. How did that idea come about?
Thank you very much, Michael. That came back, idea came back to me in 1998 when I reflected. I was a creation of the education of God. And I realized the most transformative a gift you can give to a child is education. I lost my father very early in life, and consequently, my widowed mother, who had not got formal education, realized that if she gave me education, I could be a somebody. Today, I am the chairman of Vision 2030, chief executive of Equity, because of that education. The only thing I would really claim explains my being, where I am, is education. That's why I said, there may be many James Mwangis out there. Can I reach out to one? And we started with one. Luckily, that one is today the chief executive of Equity Bank Rwanda. So you can see the impact you can create. But fortunately enough, we kept on taking, and as we expanded. So in university now, we have 3,000 kids. Out of that, 265 are in Ivy League schools. This week, we are sending 65 to international university. That is how we started. And we said, these, because they are gifted, they will be our leaders. But as we moved on, 6 years ago, we realized we were picking kids from secondary school. And we said, but free primary education aids at primary school. What about the kids who are not able to pay secondary? We are never able to reach them. So we went all the way to primary and say, let's look at the kids who do very well at primary but are not able to go to Form 1. We give them wings to fly to Form 1 and eventually to Form 4 so that they can join our leadership program. I'm happy, Michael, to say we now have 10,377 of those kids. We had a target of 10,000 in 5 years. We did 10,300. And now we are launching phase two, where we are targeting another 20,000. But what is amazing, Michael, is the reward we have got from those kids. While the average children who get an A score in this country is only 0.3, 34% of all our kids got an A grade. Well, the average number of children who get acceptance to university or meet the university grade is 27. 94% of all our kids got university grades. And 78% were admitted against an average of 12% of the children who are. That is the reward we have got from these kids. Amazing response. But we are happy because those families will now have kids who can transform not only themselves but their families and the villages. And we are proud that if we could transform 10,000 villages in 5 years or create the potential of transformation we've made, this project would never have been successful if it was not for the customers of Equity Bank who made it possible, MasterCard Foundation who supported us substantially with 5,000 scholarship, USAID, UKAID, and German Development Bank, which made it possible, and Equity did the rest. Particularly the staff, the 9,000 staff of Equity Bank, really support these, and the community district scholarship committees or boards that are responsible for selecting the kids.
Okay. We do know that the former president of the U.S., Bill Clinton, is also very involved. How did you manage to get him involved in something that local and yet so inspiring?
Thank you very much, Michael. As I said earlier, I serve on the advisory board of the Bill Clinton Global Initiative. Mm-hmm. And it's from there the conversation that we invited him to come and learn or see what we are doing, mm-hmm. in the hope that the Clinton Global Initiative could support us to build partners for phase two. And I'm really glad that President Clinton has now introduced three potential partners, and hopefully by September we'll get the commitment of people who out he has been able to reach and say, as he said, This is the most moving project he has ever seen, the most inspiring project he has ever seen, the most transformational project for Africa. So he committed himself to help us get partners. So I am confident that we'll be able to roll out the 10,000 scholarships by January.
Okay. Now, such a move is subject to abuse, obviously, and people who would misuse it. One, how does one qualify to be on Wings to Fly? And secondly, what measures are there to ensure that this is not abused and those who absolutely need it are the ones who get it?
Thank you very much. The mechanism we have built is that make it a grassroots-based program. Make the community decide. So essentially what we do is that we ask all applicants, and we have defined who an applicant is. An applicant must be somebody who is absolutely needy, have nobody who can be able to support them. They are challenged. Today, when we look, 86% of our children are orphans. So that is a testament. That second thing we said, the community, then we give them all the application. The applications are received by the agents and the branches. Then we give this selection board, which is the community-based board. They do the selection. Normally they will have about 100 to 200 applications and they have to select 25. And then once they select, they give the branch which they are attached to and say, this is the ones we have selected. The branch staff then visit every home to validate and to verify. They visit every primary school where these kids are coming from. They visit every shift and we do the documentation. And I must say we have been very lucky that there is very little abuse. There has been a lot of respect for this program that is intended for the most vulnerable in our society.
All right, as we wind up, you talked about regional trade, and I'd just be interested to hear your take on the current hullabaloo that's been going on about the sugar. From an economic angle, what's your take?
Michael, I don't want to get into this because it seems to be a very hot subject. But I think this is about regional trade. One of the things we have done is we have signed protocols about open markets within the trade. So I think the case being pushed is, why get sugar from Brazil? Why get sugar from Middle East? Why get sugar from South Africa, which is not within the East African community, if an East African community country can produce sugar? The question is, the bringing in the competitive advantage of every country. Why doesn't every country focus on what it can do very, very well? Essentially, there are fundamental issues that we need to confront about our sugar industry, if we put the politics aside. In a globalized economy, you can never be able to sustain an industry on protection. Because essentially what you are doing is denying 43 million Kenyans affordable sugar. So the question is, if you can't fix it, then solve the problem, the underlying problem. We need to ask ourselves, how do we make our sugar industry competitive? Because essentially, if you look, it's not sustainable. We keep on piling debts, and taxpayers have to keep on bailing these companies out. For how long will you be able to do? Those are the fundamental questions. However, we also need to think about, if we don't address the livelihoods of Kenyans, in rural areas, who constitute 85% of the population, will continue to widen the gap of those living in rural areas and earning from agriculture and those who have gone to commerce and industry and globalized. And that is where we need to ask ourselves, how do we address the productivity of our agriculture, the value addition in our agriculture? How do we make agriculture competitive? Remember, the aspiration of Vision 2030 is to make Kenya a globally competitive economy. Unless anything is competitive, then we are really being derailed. Mm-hmm. But I think it's I would appeal for soberness so that we approach this not just from a short-term aid, but long-term. Without negating the need to give alternative source of income to the farmers if we find it's not viable. Okay. But I think it's also important we promote regional trade, particularly within the community, because that is what will create the cost of bringing sugar across the border in Busia is much cheaper than the cost of getting sugar from Brazil. So essentially, okay, we need to be open to a dialogue, but then we see what is good for
the way forward.
Good for the farmers, good for the country, good for our region.
Last and final question. Would you go into politics?
Never.
Consider. Why not?
Because I think we have eloquent, astute politicians, and we need to create role models in business.
All right.
What we really need in this country is corporate. We are now talking we want to promote business, but we can't be killing and attracting those who are demonstrating success in business into politics. We are very successful politicians. What we really need to create is role models in business so that our children can have role models. And we need also to show business success is as good as political success. I think this country, we have defined success only in political leadership.
All right.
You as an anchor here, I consider you a leader in the media industry. We need business leaders, and all of us need to respect and be proud of what we do.
Thank you very much, Dr. James Mwangi, for joining us in the
studio.
And that's where we wind up. Person of interest today, Dr. James Mwangi, who is the Chief Executive Officer for Equity Bank. Do stand by. Sophia Wanuna is coming up next with Lifestyle, where she'll be talking on matters abortion.